first years, and then litigation practice skills second years. And I'm also the chair of the Professional Development Committee, and we're concerned about student professionalism. Okay, and so this is Lauren Lee. Yes, she works in student affairs, and you'll get to know her well. Here's our roadmap for today. We're going to define professionalism, talk about what that means, and then we're going to focus on professionalism on campus and online. You have different presentations about professionalism when you go out into externships and internships, and when you work in the community, and so I'm going to address that. You also have presentations on plagiarism, which is a professionalism issue, clearly. Okay, defining professionalism. Okay, so I know you're young people, so you think about professional athletes, maybe stars, maybe something like that. You know, you think, what makes you think about what is it to be a professional athlete? What does it require?
Skill.
Work.
What else?
Hard work.
Hard work, dedication, right? And then you think about the professional athletes who really, they're sort of good role models, right? Some of them are. Okay, well, it's true for lawyers too. It's true for lawyers too. And lawyers, to be a professional lawyer, a really good lawyer, to embody professionalism, it requires a lot of hard work, a lot of attention to detail, a lot of hours, a lot of commitment, but it also requires sort of walking the walk, right? And living like a person of honor, right? Keeping your word, being polite to opposing counsel, respecting everybody, doing community service in your community. Think about the professional athletes you look up to. You want to be that kind of lawyer, a lawyer for people to look up to. Okay, so professionalism in the law is essential because basically our bread and butter is being able to serve clients and be the kind of lawyer that clients want to come back to for more sage advice. And so in order to get referrals and to get clients, or even if you work for the government, in order to have that job and to flourish in that job, you have to have a sterling reputation. And how do you earn a sterling reputation? By acting professionally, right? By being honest, being diligent, being competent. Also, though, I think this is very important, by not being like some of the attorneys you see on TV. You get this notion that they're real pit bulls and fighters, and it's not the way it is to practice law in Jacksonville. It's very collegial here, it really is. And so you don't just follow the technical rules, you are flexible and good to the opposing counsel, and polite to the opposing counsel. So a lot of law students come into law school thinking that it's their job to be, you know, the gun for hire, but that's not really what it's like to be a lawyer. You'll see that people will sit across the table in a mediation, attorneys across the table for one another, and then they'll be very polite, and afterwards they, you know, they might be friends on the baseball field when they coach their children's teams. It's a very collegial place, and so if opposing counsel asks you for an extension because he has a funeral to attend, you grant it, or you agree to it, right? It's more collegial than TV leads you to believe. Okay, so your bread and butter is going to be built around your reputation, and so you want to be the type of person that other attorneys trust and they want to trust. Okay, so your professional reputation begins here in law school. And so unlike in undergrad, where it was often a party scene, right? And you might not be thinking of your classmates as future colleagues or supervisors. In law school, I'm telling you, now I'm 45, a lot of my classmates are now judges, hiring partners. Your classmates become the colleagues and supervisors and judges you will have in the future. And so you start earning your reputation now as someone they would want to work with, as someone they would trust, which means you're not meanly competitive, you're cooperative. If someone asks you to explain something, do. It helps you and it helps them. That's what earns you a good reputation amongst your classmates, right? And that's the kind of person that someone wants to work with in the future. Okay, so law school is different than undergrad. You've heard that. What does it mean to be professional in law school? Okay, first in the classroom, you've got to respect your professor. Okay. Professors are often the link you have to your first job, right? I still call some of my law school professors and ask for career guidance. And I use some of my law school professors as references for years after graduation. So you need to try to build relationships with your professors. And how do you do that? You're polite in class. You're on time to class, right? You're prepared for class, right? And that's the kind of, if you impress upon a professor that you're really interested in becoming a lawyer and you really want to be a good one, that professor is going to be happy to write you a letter of recommendation for an internship or for your first job. If you come up and ask a professor and all they remember is that you were often late to class and you were wearing pajamas half the time, they're really not going to write that letter of recommendation. They're not going to have anything to say. And so, be good to your professors, not just because it's the right thing to do, but because it's good for you. It's good for you. It's good for your future. And so, respect the professor even if you don't like the subject. Ask the right questions. So what that means is if the question can easily be answered after a little diligence on your part, then first do the work, okay? So don't email your professor and say, hey, what's our textbook? You can easily find that on D2L or at the bookstore. Do that first, right? If you've ever been out in the workforce, you'll learn that supervisors love employees who find information on their own. You don't bother them with bunches of questions that can easily be answered by the employee. Be that kind of student. Be that kind of student. So when you go into office hours, after you've struggled with a concept and come up with some good questions, that's the time to see the professor, not just to come in and have the professor teach you something that you haven't even tried to learn yourself, right? So you want to respect other people's time, which means respect your professor time. We have an open door policy here and we love to see students. But the students you love to engage with are the ones that have already struggled with it as much as they can and now they really have a question. It's not the person who comes in and contracts and says, I just don't get consideration. Can you just explain it all? Struggle with it a little more before you do that, right? Think about it a little more before you do that. Okay, so prepare for class as if you were preparing for court. So what does that mean? It means don't be late. It's a big deal to be late to court. It's a big deal to be late to court. It's a dumb thing to be late for a job interview or a client meeting. It's also a dumb thing to be late to class. And in class, professors will have attendance rosters. It's up to you to sign it. Make sure you do. And don't forget, because then you have to email the professor and do a bunch of bothering the professor to sign and stuff, and that's not respecting the professor's time. Okay? So be responsible for signing in the attendance and being on time to class, if not early to class. Okay, know when you're there to talk about, not just showing to sit and listen. You have to struggle with the material, engage the material before you come to class. Right? You should do a couple hours of work for every hour of class beforehand. Okay? Be respectful of the professor with cell phones and electronic devices. Professors will set policies about such things. Many professors ban laptops in class, and there's lots of data to show that that is a good thing for your learning. So if that's the policy that's been set, respect it. There's a lot of data out there that says that people visit Facebook the whole time. And some of that data, I must say, I've seen it. So, yes, that adds. Another thing when you're coming to class is that you are now entering professional school. And you want to be a lawyer, or maybe a change of preferred career in the business world, or something like that, or a policymaker in the government. All those kinds of people dress professionally. Okay? If you want to wear a suit and tie, if you're a man, if you want to, or a woman, whatever, anybody, you want to wear a suit and tie, you can wear suits too. If you want to wear a suit to class, wear a suit to class, that's great. You don't have to wear a suit, but you should look professional, sort of like business casual. Okay? Okay, now, it's not just about respecting your professor, it's about respecting your classmates. It's about respecting your classmates, and what that means is to collaborate with each other, to be helpful. Don't see your classmates as people who could get better grades than you and that sort of thing. You have to start seeing each other as teammates. I've worked with many classmates in the future. You might, right? And so they learn these three years that you're someone good to work with. That's a potential job opportunity down the road, okay? So be courteous of your classmates. Don't giggle when someone asks a question in class. It's silly, don't do that, right? Don't call out in class and interrupt someone, right? Mostly professionalism is just being courteous. And this is your time to cultivate relationships, not just with professors, but also with your classmates. Cultivate relationships with your classmates because these classmates, like I said, one day become colleagues. Okay, so professionalism doesn't just end at the classroom door. It also is all over campus, and that means in the elevator, because you never know who's in the elevator when you're telling your tall tale about the night before. Could be a judge in the elevator here for CLE. Could be a hiring partner in the elevator. So don't tell Tom and tall tale in the elevator. You're on campus. In the parking garage, don't drive fast. Don't want to hit anyone in the parking garage. Okay? That's part of being courteous, is respecting other people's safety. Don't boom your radio so loud in the parking garage that people can't hear. Respect the safety rules. Okay? In the library, respect the rules of the library. People are trying to study in the library, right? So be quiet, get books back on time, that kind of thing. This is professionalism on campus. Okay, so what does it mean to be professionally dressed? Nice jeans and pants are fun. Longer shorts and skirts. You're not clubbing. Collared shirts, clean, nice t-shirts, clean, collared. Conservative tops, sneakers, mid-height, some high heels, right? It's practical. You have to walk around to lots of classes. You don't need 6-inch heels. Wearing a belt. Think about school uniforms when you were younger. It's not ripped or tight jeans and pants. It's not short shorts and skirts. It's not unclean, dirty, or offensive clothes. It's not tops that are revealing. It's not stiletto heels, and it's not low-rider pants. Think, what do I want my lawyer to look like when I see him at the grocery store or her? Right? And so everybody knows that the lawyer's not always in a suit, but we don't need to see the lawyer dressed really sexy. Okay. Social events. So not only will you be together in class and collaborating and together in the library, and on the elevator, and in the parking garage, you will have social events. And sometimes there will be alcohol offered at these social events. And lawyers are very social creatures. And the bar is always having little cocktail parties and such. Okay? But that is not the time to get drunk. Right? And you will get presentations about the damage that a DUI can do to your life and your career, and potentially to the safety of others or yourself. So do not drink and drive. Do not abuse alcohol. Act appropriately. It's not the time to tell off-color jokes, that sort of thing, right? Act like a future lawyer. Okay, so what do you do if you see unprofessional behavior on campus by your peers? What do you do? Okay, so you have options. One is to talk to the student, talk to your classmate. This is a nice thing to do to someone. Instead of going higher and immediately taking it to the highest level, it's good to approach the person and try to instruct them and help the person. That's what's collaborative. That's what you'd want to happen to you. If you did something inappropriate and you just didn't think about it, and someone pointed it out to you, you would probably prefer that option rather than it being ignored or being told to a higher authority. Okay, so you could start with that. And it's a good time to talk, to learn to talk about things that are a little bit uncomfortable, because you'll have to do that in the workforce. You'll have to do that with people who work for you, people with whom you work, and you'll have to do that with clients. There's always, you know, kind of difficult situations to work through as a lawyer and in the workforce generally. So it gives you an opportunity to do that. If you're not comfortable doing that, that, and then you could seek assistance from your professors, or staff, or from the deans.
I think I have a couple things to add on this section. So you guys already know me. You heard me a few times, Lauren, from Student Affairs. So I just want to make a couple of comments, because Student Affairs works very closely with professors and other staff to address unprofessional behavior. So what we really want to look at, and I think one thing that I really like that Professor Clausen addressed, was the respect issue and the civility issue. We know that everybody here is an adult, and we hear it all the time, I'm an adult, and so we want people to act like an adult. But we do have instances of bullying. We have it on Facebook. We have people mistreating others in school. Not a lot, but it happens when you get this many people together. You get people from different backgrounds. You get people with different personalities. And so we really encourage everyone to have their own conflict resolution skills, work out your own problems, talk about it. And if you do need help or something is really concerning, please do come to us and we will help you out. I can't emphasize enough what Professor Clausen said about the professionalism on campus. We're going to talk about online professionalism in a few minutes, which is also important. But people watch the way that you act in school. Your colleagues watch it. Staff and faculty watch. Your law career has already started. You've already been observed. And so you always want to be putting your best foot forward. You always want to show people that you're confident. And you really want to abide by these things. We do have some issues that happen. And a lot of them are professionalism. And when we get to communication, I'm going to emphasize that. But from a student affairs point of view, a lot of the conduct code and the honor code covers this. But I just really want to emphasize the importance of treating each other well. Yes, law school is on a curve. And I think sometimes that provides people with some anxiety. And competition kind of kicks in. But the ones that get ahead are the ones that really cultivate the relationships, the ones that really work together and collaborate, because that's how you learn the best. And I really can't emphasize enough also the professional dress piece. Please just think about that. You don't always have to be dressed up. You don't have to wear a suit every day. But you always want to look presentable. And so just please consider that when you're to school.
Okay, and so it's good to deal with unprofessional incidents here because the bar cares about this. And so this is your training to sort of start to try to, or to learn to be professional. And so we have to deal with unprofessional. Okay, professionalism online. What's the first thing you do when you meet someone? Lock your Google them, right? You have to start thinking of your online presence. When I went to law school, this didn't exist. My reputation was built on interpersonal relations and interactions in the real world. Now, there's a whole presence out there, and people have this presence, might not even know what it looks like. So, things like Facebook, can't explain it, I just feel like someone's Googling me. Social media, you don't want your Facebook page to look like you're the perfect person. Right? Again, future lawyer. And you've probably heard this. Employers, when they get applicants, Google them and try to check out what their Facebook pages look like, and they do all that. They do all that. So you're setting a sort of footprint out there, and what do you want that to look like? And a lot of people post things on Facebook that are irreverent and very pretty.
Yeah.
On Facebook, but this is, especially when you're in your younger days, this is not the kind of image you want to portray anymore, okay? I know that when my little brother became a clerk, he just got off Facebook. He was clerking for a judge, and he just said, you know what, I'm just not going to communicate this way. I don't think that's necessary, but you have to start thinking about your online presence. Realize that people will see this stuff. Another thing is that texting and emailing, if any of you become litigators, you'll never email or text freely again. You'll always think about it again. You shouldn't be overly emotional or angry in writing like that at all, ever. And so if a professor has made you mad with your grade, don't just reel off an angry email. It's time to think about it. Think of an email as a piece of correspondence. Right? And the reason I say if you ever become a litigator is you'll see, if you're in an employment discrimination suit or something, you're the attorney representing, you'll see that every email the person ever sent is now discoverable. And it'd be amazing. You'd be amazed at what people do on their work email. So start thinking about your lawyers now, and start thinking about each correspondence you put in writing like that, even a text. Is this the kind of thing you want to be creating a record of? Is it appropriate? Is it emotional? Is it, I mean, emotion is appropriate, it's not, should be professional.
Yes. I will jump in at this point. One rule that I always go by and I recommend, give it an hour. Sometimes we all get emails and we're like, oh heck no, and you want to like pound out a response and then send it back. And it usually doesn't go that well. So often what I do is that I'll just walk away for a little while, go have lunch, work on something else, come back to it. I would definitely encourage you to do that so that you can go back, look at what you've read, and then make sure it's really what you want to send. We get in our office emails from professors that are forwarded from students that were very inappropriate, that weren't professionally written. You don't want to write it like a text message with the word, you know, the letter U as U. You want to write things out. This is a professional correspondence. No emojis, anything like that. Sometimes I get emojis through email and I'm like, no, I don't think that's really appropriate. So you always want to think about that when you're communicating. The other thing I can tell you is respond to emails. I cannot tell you how often we email students and they just never respond. Never respond. So then what happens is that they don't get what they need, or they have some kind of penalty, or the next time they come back and they're like, well, I didn't know about this. It's like, well, you didn't read your email. We know that you guys get a lot of emails. We definitely know that. But you are responsible just as you would be in the professional field. I'm responsible for every single email that comes in. I'm responsible for reading it, knowing it, and responding. And if I don't respond or I don't read it, that's on me. So that's one tip that I can really share. Some of you that have been in the professional world are like, yeah, this is old news to me. But always think about it and please respond to emails when they come through. And in timely fashion, try to respond within a day or two. I know that you're busy, but it's important to try to get back to people. I want to talk a little bit about the social media piece. Professor Clausen is absolutely right that people are going to be looking at your social media accounts. And it doesn't mean that you can't have your own Facebook, Instagram, whatever you want to do, and you can't express your opinions. We know that, and that's what social media is for, and you should be able to do that. But now that you're a professional student, you do just have to think twice about what you put online, and we know, anybody knows, that what you put online is not private, even if you set your privacy settings to private. Students come in and go, well, that was private. I'm like, well, somebody found it and gave it to us, so it really wasn't private. Also, just pay attention to the comments that you write. You know how everybody has Facebook? If I comment on something, it shows up in everyone else's newsfeed that I commented on it, and I can look and see exactly what people commented. It's okay to comment and have a social media presence, but you really just want to be smart about what you're doing. Change your privacy settings so that people can't automatically tag you with things, because you can't control what other people do. Can't control what your friends do, and then like all of a sudden you wake up and there's all these awful pictures of you online that everyone's already seen and your mother's like tapping on it. So please do yourself a favor and really set your privacy settings, but also just monitor your online presence. I really can't emphasize it enough, especially online searches, content, blogs. You can blog about things that you want to blog about. Please, religion, politics, go ahead and blog about them. Just make sure that you're doing it in a professional setting and that you're not putting other people down. We do have instances, unfortunately, of online bullying here, and the way I see it come about the most is that somebody's doing something in class that somebody else doesn't like, so somebody posts about it on Facebook during class, and the whole class starts commenting about it, and it's like timestamped, so we can see, one, that you were on Facebook during class, two, that you're doing it, and three, that it is disrespectful and probably a common code violation. So please be smart about the things that you do online and in your email presence. And we always say everyone online is a real person. So one of the issues that comes up with society, with technology, and being a digital native, people that have always grown up with technology, is that it's sort of easy to, you know, the comments, to spout off things about whatever you feel like or about somebody without thinking that that person is sitting on the other end of the computer reading that about themselves. So that's the problem, is that it's easy to comment something and then you don't have to see how it affects the real person. You don't have to stand there. So if I wrote something about Judy and she's not here, I don't have to worry about it essentially. But if she's in front of me, then I have to deal with the emotions that come along with that and see her reaction. And so being online gives people an escape route not to do that. But just remember when you're making these comments that everybody online or somebody else on the other side that's receiving that or that's about them. So, and the technology, of course, is always evolving and there's always something new. We try to stay on top of it. First it was Yik Yak, then it was Yeti. Like, there's all these things that are supposedly anonymous and that you post, like, cut it, don't do it. You're a professional student, you're a law student, and it's very, very different from being an undergrad. So I just wanted to pop in because we see that a lot in our office. it out there now. Now you've heard it beginning, so keep it in mind when you are going through your law school career and as your career as a lawyer. We've seen many lawyers be brought down. But even think about right now, Hillary Clinton's emails are being very much scrutinized by what she's done. So you see it go all the way to the top. So you always have to think about, and it's tough. I know as a counselor, I said on my diversity section when I did it that I'm bound by certain rules and I have to act in a certain way, but the payoff is that I get to have this awesome career and do what I want. So if I give a speech on professionalism and then you guys see me out at a restaurant or a bar acting like a fool later on, you all probably would recognize me, but I would probably not recognize all of you. So you never really know who's watching, and I don't say that to tell you not to have fun, not to go out, not to do things with your friends, but you do have a different standard of behavior now than you may have had before. You never know who's around or who might see it, and so you always do have to watch your back. It makes it a little bit difficult, but it really cleans up your behavior, first of all. And second of all, the payoff is that you need to be a law student, and I think that's the biggest payoff of all.
Okay, any questions before we get started with hypotheticals? So what we have here, these are real things that have happened, and we sort of solicited hypotheticals from their sort of factual scenarios with the identifying data removed of things that professors had to witness. And so what we're going to do is use these hypotheticals kind of like you do in a law school class. But instead of talking about the sort of technical model rules of professional responsibility, we're just going to talk about the professionalism aspects of these hypotheticals that we sort of already intuitively know. Okay? Okay. The student club meets in a classroom during lunch. Members listen to a guest speaker. Pizza is served. After the meeting, the club leaves empty pizza boxes stacked in a corner of the room. An hour later, a professor walks into the room to prepare to deliver his lecture in a few minutes, and the professor has to clean the mess. Okay, so this really happened. So, what's wrong with this? Someone raise their hand and discuss the professionalism. Raise your hands up, yes.
It's just inconsiderate.
Yeah, mostly professionalism. I mean, if you listen to the theme or the thread of this whole talk, it's mostly about being considerate. It's about being considerate. And how it's in your self-interest to be considerate, right? It's also the right thing to do. But here, this is unprofessional because it's left, no one's taking responsibility, and this is a campus, and even though we do have lunches and those sort of things on campus, it's primarily for academic activities, and so the person left to deal with this mess is the professor who's about to give his lecture. And so if you leave a mess, or your club leaves a mess, then make sure before you leave the room, someone picks it up. It's just about being courteous. A student, believing that the professor is mistaken about his grade calculation, sends the following email. Professor, I didn't feel like I had very many significant corrections on assignment 2, but based on the math, I only got 3 points. Is this right? It comes as a bit of a surprise. I spent at least 4 hours on assignment 2. And then, struggling face. Okay. Yes.
Well, you shouldn't ever email a professor specifically about a grade. You should always go and speak to them in person.
That probably is the best judgment. And if you remember from a self-interest perspective, your professors can help you find great opportunities, and they can be your allies. But you read this, and you as the professor are just not real excited to be the ally. It's kind of a tactic and accusatory. And it doesn't show the, it's almost kind of, I mean, the professor is not the judge, but it's a little bit like that. It doesn't show very much respect or authority. It's okay to talk about your grade, but to presume that the professor has somehow erred because you spent a lot of time, it's very annoying to the professor. So you have not created a friend. And second, it's not as good a judgment, right? If you're going to talk about something a little uncomfortable, then it's best to set up with a very polite email to set up an appointment and to sit down and to humbly say, I worked really hard, I don't understand, where did I go wrong, explain to me. Instead of presuming that it must be the other person who's at fault. You know, it
It's entitled. That just because you work hard, you should have gotten a good grade. Not the way it works. You have to
get over that.
Yeah.
Okay. Because there's no great grade inflation in law school. This is an honest curve. And so grade inflation is a real phenomenon where, you know, the good faith issue of B. There are no guarantees. You work super, super hard, it doesn't mean now you get the A because you work super, super hard. There's very few A's in it. And so this idea that, you know, I put in the investment and I get the return, well, only if you show, if you perform as such, and you can put in a lot of work and not perform as such. And so there are no guarantees. And this idea that you can somehow secure something like this is entitled. And it's not accurate.
It's not accurate. We have students that insist that because they pay tuition, they should get certain grades or certain privileges, and that's just totally unprofessional. And I can find 1,000 emails that are much, much worse than this one. This is sort of a docile one, but this was a recent one. We asked for professors, and the professor had just received this one when we asked for it. So, we're too wise.
Humility is huge.
Yep. It really is. And accountability.
Yep.
Accountability.
Accountability.
Yeah.
And I tell you, a good grade is something you can improve on, right? And you can go to a professor with a bad grade and not make a bad impression at all. You can make a great impression. So this is a bad grade and a bad impression. Okay, your roommate texts you and asks you to sign her in. She was out late, you think she's just gonna sleep in. Signing in is the attendance roster in class, and remember, it's on you to remember to sign in. Okay. Someone raise their hand and discuss this. Yes.
It's an integrity issue.
It is an integrity issue,
yes.
And for a friend, you have put your name on the line. Your integrity on the line. Right? And don't do that.
Great. So what's the right answer? When your roommate, your best friend, someone that you know has been struggling, needs you to sign them in, what do you say? Sorry, I can't. Yeah, we've had this. It's against the honor code issue. It's against the honor code, which our office administers. There's a lot of chat about this one, but we see this in the honor code all the time, and both people are held accountable equally, the person that asked to be signed in and the person that actually signed them in. And when I interview people about it, and they say, well, I felt bad for it's my roommate. I felt bad. I didn't want to say no. Sometimes hard to say no, but when you're in law school, you've got to do the right thing, and I liked your answer that it's an integrity issue, because it really, really is. Integrity is everything. Integrity and professionals are everything.
And everybody in this class, and everybody makes a mistake.
Yeah.
But you will, as lawyers, make a mistake. You will, as lawyers, you know, you'll miss something. You'll be late at something. And it's never worth covering that up and losing your integrity, compromising your integrity. That's the thing.
Any accusation of a conduct or honor court does have to be reported to any state bar. Even just the accusations with state bars, and you'll see that when you hear from Florida Board of Bar Examiners tomorrow. But even just the accusation usually has to be reported, even if you haven't been found responsible for it. So just think about that so that you can manage your behavior appropriately.
Your roommate texts you and asks you to sign her in. She's been up all night throwing up. So here what we're trying to do is compel you a little more, your empathy button, but still, tell your roommate, talk to the professor, and you know, I recommend you talk to the professor, but don't compromise your integrity, even if you feel empathetic. A student emails a professor to ask what textbooks are needed for the class, and asks the professor to provide the author, edition, year, and ISBN number. This is real. Okay. Someone raise their hand and tell me, discuss this. Yes, it's not respecting the professor's time. You know, it's not respecting the professor's time. And so, this is really important in the workforce. It's really important in the workforce because, you know, you can bring someone onto your team who immediately contributes and who has, you know, a lot of wherewithal to find information and to not ask for answers because they're too lazy to go find them. And so if that's possible, do it first. It sends the right impression. It's good training for the workforce because we hear from the legal community. What the legal community wants is people that are ready to go. Okay, and this kind of thing sent to a partner would be so bothersome. and interruptive than it is to a professor too, because you can so easily find this information. If you've learned that, you know, it's not posted anywhere, and you've tried, and you've put some time in, then maybe you've gotten to the time. But you're not there yet.
Another thing along with that line is check the student handbook and the website first. I get so many emails, and I don't mind responding to them because I want to help the student, but usually all I do is type in like character and fitness into the school's website box, and I get the answer, and then I just send them a link and tell them how to do it. But I really like you to do that first. Most professors and staff have their contact information on their email signature, so a lot of people are like, where can I find you, even though it's like on the email signature. That kind of thing just takes you one extra step, and it goes a long way. Another note about your email signature, that should just be your name and your contact information and a title if you have one. What we see is that students have an email signature like that long with a member of every single club and organization that they're ever in, and it's just unprofessional. You don't need it. You just need your contact info and your title, so we see it. I mean, and then I'm like, how is this person even doing all this? And then I question it. It's like, no. So, like, you're a member of the Animal Law Society 3 years ago. It doesn't need to be on there. So, search the website and the student handbook, control F, control find, and the student handbook is going to be your best friend.
And so, student emails the professor to ask which of the books listed by the bookstore for the class the student actually needs for purchasing. Someone have a hand to put up to discuss this? Yes. Yes, and another thing is, what message does this send? Is this person thirsty for knowledge? So I often get the, what do we need to know? Because I don't want to bother studying anything I'm not going to be assessed on. And so that is just, again, think of that professor as someone who you want to enthusiastically recommend you positions of responsibility. And what kind of lawyers make good lawyers? Not lawyers who want to know the bare minimum and read the fewest books possible, right? You want lawyers who are ambitious, lawyers who want to understand everything they can. You know, there is concern with assessment, but they're also concerned with they want to practice this one day. This isn't just about the test. You're going to do this. And so you want to send that, you want to have that vibe, and you want to send that vibe. It's like, what can I do? Okay. Student walks into class late. He's 2 minutes late. What do you think?
Late.
Yes. Anybody raising hand? Yes. Yeah. I mean, you know, things happen. But this prompt thing is really important in the law. It's really important. And I think it's because of judges' calendars and clients' time. It's just really important. It probably is in every professional setting. So this is your opportunity to start practicing. And when you walk into class late, and I can tell you because I've experienced it a million times, it completely derails the professor. About half of the class rolls their eyes and looks at you. And so it's very disruptive. It really is. And it's hard to realize that. And I know you had car trouble and yada, yada, yada. But you realize that it has implications. It is a professionalism issue. And you know, when you become a practitioner, like I said, you'll make mistakes, you won't be perfect before the judge, but being late is rude. So you gotta really try to be on time. Yeah. You know, you can ask your individual professor that. When it comes to a guest speaker, and you have like an attorney from in town or a judge, it's better to miss it, I think, in my opinion. Because it really sends a bad impression. And your professor can tell you what she wants, right? She might say, no, you know, you can't help it. And what I like is if it's happened, but there was a reason for it, and if it's somewhat compelling, then the student will always, out of politeness, not to ask for an excuse, but just out of politeness will explain. I like that. But not to, the professor can't really do that either.
No.
The professor can't excuse things. There are certain things that are excused, and then the rest of it's up to the dean suite.
Yeah, I don't know if you have you heard about the attendance policy yet? Has that come up? Probably not, because you haven't had academic rules through the academic deans yet. But in most of your first year classes, you're allowed to have up to 5 absences, and then after that, you're withdrawn from the class with an F. So if you have to miss class for any reason, I would just collect documentation of that. You're saying you're in the hospital, you're a doctor, a car, whatever. And then if you exceed the attendance policy, you do have to submit a waiver to the academic deans. They'll tell you a little bit about that. A lot of professors count tardiness as being absent, and students rack it up that way. And they're like, oh, 22 minutes late, chime. I'm like, great, well, too bad it was on the attendance policy. And I'm a late person. Like, I'm not an early bird. I've struggled with this myself. Like, I really had to work on it, and it can be done. And so you asked, I thought your question was really good about what should you do, and I like Professor Clausen's answer. You always want to attend class as much as possible, because in law school, everything that you miss is pretty essential. Everything that you miss is pretty essential. So I would try to get there. I like what Professor Clausen said, is go out, apologize, let the professor know what's happening with you, and don't make excuses, and try to fight it when there's something that happens. It's all that you have.
Okay, the student let the professor go in advance, and he let her stay up. This is better.
Better.
This is better. A student went asked via email about a deadline she missed, right back, so I was just so busy with my other classes. Okay, so, anybody? Okay, yes, this is our last one.
The exception of some religious absences, which is in the handbook and a different process. But there's no excuse.
It's up to the professor's policy, you know. I tell you though, generally, don't ask for exceptions to professor's policies, because it's difficult for the professor to manage that. Realize that when a professor has a policy, they're trying to, it's really difficult if they go and give exceptions. So it's better to set it up so you don't have to ask for exceptions. And this is our last one, so we get out of here. What do you think about this? Yeah. It is. It is disrespectful, and you know, it's funny because a lot of times students get the impression early on that certain classes are more important than others, and it's just really not true. And all your classes are important. And one of the things you have to realize is that lawyers are super busy people, and part of what they have to do is deal with a lot of stuff at once. And so this is exposure to that. This is training for that. You have a lot of different deadlines. You have a lot of different assignments. You have a lot of different classes. And even though that's the case, you have a lot of different cases. And so you have to learn how to juggle. You're not going to just be able to focus on one thing. And so if you've missed a deadline, you've missed a deadline. Own it. Apologize. But don't blame it on the fact that you had other work. So did everybody else, and you will as a lawyer.
Own it. That's the big message. Own it.